Welcome to Frame by Frame. We're looking at menus.
Yeah, we're in the pub.
Funnily enough, we are actually in a pub this time. So what are we going to talk about?
Ghost documentaries.
Yeah.
Alleged hauntings.
And
etc. etc.
And the fun connections to all these little documentaries.
From August 1977 to September 1978, a series of events took place which stunned the nation and have subsequently become one of the world's most shockingly infamous poltergeist cases.
You understand that you really shouldn't be in this
very strange goings-on of an alleged ghost or poltergeist causing havoc in their home. The story made news across the country, changing the Hodgson's lives forever. So was 284 Green Street in Enfield, North London, the most haunted house in Britain?
We actually thought, didn't we, because they're making the Conjuring 2, the Enfield Poltergeist.
Okay, yeah.
So we thought we'd discuss the real case, and then when the film eventually comes out, we can see what they've Hollywoodized and what.
But have you've seen the trailer, right?
Oh, there's a trailer for it already.
Yeah, did you not watch it?
No.
You talking to me?
Did you have a brain tumor for breakfast?
Then who the hell else are you talking? Talking to me?
I'm funny how? I mean, funny like I'm clowning you.
I'm Peter Winkler. We all go a little mad sometimes.
Man that doesn't spend time in the stomach will never be a real man.
Yeah.
Hot. Kind of a big deal.
First rule of my club is, do not talk about my club.
Yeah, baby. Yeah.
You want answers? I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!
This is the story of the Enfield Poltergeist.
That was a very strange house, and something very strange was going on there.
Everything that you know about poltergeists occurred in that house.
They were scared out of their wits. They just didn't know what was going on.
So the real case, when did this happen?
Yeah, it happened in 1977, Stephen.
I think it was, wasn't it?
Yeah, I remember thinking it was a year before I was born. The fascinating thing about it is how documented it was.
It's 14 months of activity, apparently, and multiple different angles. I mean, sure, some of those perspectives will be coming on a certain level of pre-existing knowledge. Once you get to the 14th month, everybody will know about it.
Yeah. But we're talking like police.
Police
allegedly
were the
went
first
in there
ones.
And saw things. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because all this stuff was happening, so they invited the police to come into the house to, and the police allegedly saw activity happening.
A chair moving.
Yeah, a chair moved by its own on its own and. They have to say that there's no criminal activity here. There's nothing they can do about it because it's not criminal.
On Thursday, 1st of September 1977, at approximately 1 a.m, I was on duty in my capacity as a policewoman when I received a radio message to Green Street, Enfield. I heard the sound of knocking on the wall that backs onto the next door neighbour's house. The eldest son pointed to a chair which was standing next to the sofa. I looked at the chair and noticed that it was wobbling slightly from side to side. I then saw the chair slide across the floor towards a kitchen wall. It moved approximately 3 or 4 feet and then came to rest.
But despite first-hand experience of this alleged supernatural phenomena, the police were powerless to help the family.
They were very considerate, they were very nice to the family and said that this really wasn't a police matter. They couldn't find anybody breaking the law. They were anxious to help if they could, and they really couldn't.
So the police were straight away very supportive of the family's case, even though they didn't make anything official. It was not their place. Mm. It's not their expertise to work in the field of.
But it does seem that the mother was desperate.
Yes.
And was just trying to get someone in to do something.
She needed somebody to come to be able to, you know, because you think you're going mad. Mm. I mean, you know, it's creepy. Living in a house where that's kind of stuff. I mean, you're coming from a person who has been in a place where
stuff happened. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and it's, you know, from your own experience, it is as real as anything.
Yeah.
No matter where the source is coming from.
Yeah, and whether there are natural reasons for things happening or not.
Yeah.
It's still terrifying and it's horrible to live in a place where you're scared to go to bed at night.
In fact, when we do put this out, if you go to the blog, there I'll be reissuing the interview that I had with Andy Lewin when I first met him. So that we can do it, because it's just a fascinating subject, and I think that you kind of get big feel on that kind of thing. So
what sort of things were happening in the
Enfield?
So we have the.
It started off kind of small, and then it grew. And
yeah, things
it built up.
There was a chest of drawers that moved.
Yeah.
And when the mum tried to move it back, she literally couldn't push it.
Yeah.
As if something was stopping her from pushing it.
It's clear that they weren't of the educated type. I mean, when they had the guy come in, the expert, and he came in and it was telling them that it was a poltergeist, that you had a poltergeist in the house. They didn't know what a poltergeist was. He had to actually explain it to them, point by point, you know, what it was, and you know, what they thought it was just, they just couldn't describe it because they just didn't have
the education.
Any references for it. This is before Poltergeist was even a film.
Yeah, of course.
The only
That's
ghost.
Interesting though, isn't it? It's very interesting.
It predates any of those other influences. I mean,
which gives more validity to the case, really.
Yeah, I mean, ghost stories were kind of just fanciful costume dramas, you know, where people, you know, it was all that, and that was.
We can sort of rule out that they did not watch The Innocents.
They hadn't probably watched The Innocents.
Yeah.
Maybe. I mean, maybe.
See, I never thought of it in that respect, that a family that literally have no reference to the things happening around them because they have no idea of there ever being a ghost or what a ghost or a poltergeist.
So when it starts happening, they probably are thinking natural causes to begin with. They're thinking burglars or imposters or the children being children.
Yeah.
But when, like you say, she must have got to a state where she needed the police to come in and verify it. And see things moving around, and that's something that once you've gone there opens it all up, and I think that's probably when things started to escalate.
Yeah, food.
That was quick.
There we go.
We seem to be getting some false starts, some technical problems.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is very rare. This never happens. We're usually pretty good.
For some reason, the batteries keep draining out of all our
equipment.
It's very strange.
You can't even make this stuff up.
No, much like it happened at the Enfield Poltergeist. It's true, isn't it? Where a lot of the equipment that they
video using, equipment they couldn't use.
Yeah, it just drained.
Audio equipment, they seem to be able to record on tapes, not a problem, because they didn't have batteries. I guess it was all power, wasn't it? Main power.
Yeah.
They got all those tapes, which is impressive, but outside broadcasters came in with cameras and actually talked to Janet while she was possessed.
Right.
There's one video on YouTube of her talking and her sister just sitting there looking like, I've had enough.
These teenage sisters believe they're haunted by a poltergeist.
I was going to ask the same question as I asked earlier. How many voices are there?
600
the voices.
Oh no, the joke.
How many really are there, Margaret?
I think so far we've had 10.
Three.
Sensible voices. But the rest of the names are absolute rubbish.
Yeah, it doesn't seem fun. I mean, this whole thing that they're doing, it's not fun.
And I don't know if they made any money out of it. They certainly didn't try and like write a book about it and make money out of it that way.
I mean, like you say, you said to me that you've seen Janet Winters. Did you see her on the this morning?
Yeah, yeah, and she just looks like a
broken
person. Yeah.
Many people said, you know, that they couldn't understand how you could sustain this voice, which was very raspy, without it actually hurting your throat. Were you aware that when it happened that these words were coming out of your mouth, uncontrolled or controlled by you?
Uncontrolled. It wasn't controlled by me, I wouldn't say so.
Could you hear them at the time, or were
I could hear them, but it just didn't feel like it. It felt like it was behind me, not within me. And at one point, Maurice Gross take my mouth up, and he filled my mouth with water, and it still spoke.
Mm-hmm. So it came out even though you've got a mouthful of water.
I think a lot of that was due to the pressure of being on television again, because she's been at least one of the people who have been least talking about it. She hadn't really done anything before.
Right.
And I think she was feeling a little bit like annoyed because she had the skeptic right next to her, and she was very on edge about that. And but
that skeptic was a bit of a prick.
Yeah, redundantly tactless,
yeah.
And just saying, oh, but she, a skeptic shouldn't actually give any opinion of what she thinks happened. She can only say what she thinks did not happen. That's what a skeptic should be. They don't weigh in with their opinions of it was the children messing around. They should just say, well, the paranormal hasn't been proved, so they need to start thinking about the natural things first before you... I mean, she didn't say anything like that.
And yeah, and to say, like, I wasn't there, so I can't really speculate on anything.
No, she can't.
So to give informed point of view, where she... Anyway, yeah, whatever.
But she was... Yeah, it was one of those things where... Yeah.
But Janet did look like... She looks vacant and...
Yeah.
Like she has been through some sort of trauma.
Exactly, and I don't see money coming out of her hair.
There's no volume in it at all.
It was literally just flat, and it looked like a wig, actually. I don't know if she purposely changed her appearance to be on television at all, or, you know, it's one of those things that... She doesn't want to be recognised for it. She doesn't want to be a part of it. She knows that, you know, even if there is embarrassment at the fact that they did fake it, just for the publicity, for the fun of it, you know, she's not enjoying it now. And so, you know, it's not really...
Yeah, and... It just... The eyewitnesses...
So many of them.
Yeah, like, we've got the police we've spoken about. We've got, the...
The journalist...
Yeah, the journalist, obviously, he saw quite a lot of phenomenon.
Yeah, Nicol, who was the guy who was working on the Melvin Harris.
And you've got the lollipop lady.
She was
walking past the house, looked up and allegedly saw Janet levitating in her own bedroom.
Yeah. I mean, people don't just...
And, you know, lollipop ladies are the most honest people in the world.
Yeah, and you can trust them as much as you can trust airline pilots.
Yeah. Too soon?
Too soon. But, you know, an airline pilot is to UFOs what a lollipop lady is to ghost investigators.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody always cites that they are reliable people. And luckily, that's not entirely true for every single professional. And to say that, you know, they always say, well, pilots in the army... said this or a UFO. I mean, who can you actually say legitimately, if I say that there are ghosts, then it must be true.
See, it's not just one, it's not the one person.
No.
It's a gathering of people who witness a certain event.
Exactly. It's not just one person, it's many people, and over a length of time, you know.
Yeah, like in York, a group of people saw a Roman legion literally run through a wall, and it was witnessed by a dozen people.
So that's a bizarre one.
You can't, you know, you can't start to say, right, all right, well, these things don't exist.
You can't say these things don't exist, but at the same time, you can't say that they do, but you can say that something happened that we still can't understand, and that thing could be a shared experience, or it could be something that's physically there.
Yeah.
You know.
There's something, a lot to be said about, we don't understand what we can do with our own minds. You know, we don't tap into our full potential within our brain. So maybe there's some subconscious parts of our brain that can make things manifest, can make things move.
Yeah,
I know we talk a lot about poltergeists tend to be, where ghosts are to do with the place usually, poltergeists tend to be around a person.
Yes,
and in this case it was Janet.
Who was about to embark on womanhood.
Yeah, she was starting to go through puberty, which apparently is, this happens quite a lot.
Yeah, and I wonder if poltergeist itself as an influence used the Enfield poltergeist as a reference.
Maybe? I'm not sure.
It's hard to tell. I mean, America seems to be very insular at this time in the 70s, where it's all about their own culture. I mean, like I said, the strange thing is that the Enfield poltergeist has been out... Well, it's been a thing for almost 35 years.
Yeah.
Nobody's ever made a film about it.
We'll get there.
I know. Are you okay?
No.
You feel like there's something burning inside of you. But yeah.
You know what she did.
Do you know what they're doing? Yeah.
Okay, we'll look at the evidence then. The pictures of her levitating.
Levitating from the bed, leaping from the bed.
It does look like she's leaping. Just jumping from a bed.
Which can be done.
Yeah, but I've leapt from beds often.
But to the point where you could hurt yourself, because that looks like a very high leap.
Basically. Yeah, and the one thing you notice, the covers under the bed don't seem to be disrupted. They're not wrinkled or anything. They're just
okay. Yeah,
it's like the bed's made. So if you jumped to create that amount
there
of force,
there would be a movement of force against it, and a rustle of materials.
Yeah.
Russell and materials.
Russell materials. So, he's a good stand-up in Russell materials. But, yeah, so it's... And then there was the other one when they found her on top of, like, a... Not a wardrobe, but it was like a...
A chest.
A chest drawer. Yeah, it looked like you could jump that, maybe. Or climb up, but I'm not sure.
It's ambiguous because there's... With photographic evidence as it is now, I mean, back in the day, you'd like to say that there's a lot more credibility because there's no cultural influences out there that say that you know poltergeist activity is this, so therefore they know exactly what they're doing.
Yeah,
and there's nothing to say that the cameras have been tampered with because the level of tampering back in the day was practical and very hard to do. The fact that he was actually able to have his cameras recording. Snapping all night. That must have been a lot. I don't know what kind of cartridges they would have had for photographing things like that.
Yeah.
What I mean, it's not like they had multiple. You know, you'd still have like 60 exposures, then you'd have to change it.
Wouldn't have been. Did they have a sort of motion thing back then? So when things started to move, it then started taking pictures.
And it started to take pictures.
Was that
technology
available in the 70s?
Possibly, yeah. Unless it's purely done manually and they're watching.
Well, in interviews, the investigator, paranormal investigator, said that there was... Because Schofield sort of said, it's a bit weird that you're in there taking pictures of children in the bedroom. He said, no, we weren't in the bedroom. The cameras were just on there and taking pictures, so...
That's it.
The levitation started off with the girls sort of just sliding out of bed. And then it got more and more impressive, and then we ended up with a sequence of pictures of them, what I'm told is, levitating. When that camera went off, it photographed about 5 frames of a girl starting off, coming out of bed, and then ending up on the floor. The doctor came round and gave her a shot, and he said something like, this would put a horse or an elephant out. And she's still fighting. And it ended up with about 2 or 3 of us trying to hold her down, and this was after the sedation.
Later on that night, she was found, 10, 15 feet at the other end of the room, up on a dresser. That's quite a shocking thing in itself.
We were all downstairs, big bang, everyone rushes upstairs, her uncle goes in first, finds her on the radio, I walk in with the camera, bang.
Had that experience of levitation, which was witnessed from the street outside. Rather, as you saw in The Exorcist, her head didn't go around in circles, but the lollipop lady right across the road saw her floating around the room in midair, and it frightened the life out of her.
The fact that they weren't playing on it, that they weren't... That there was nothing. There's nothing that they got caught on that was fabricated.
Yeah.
They weren't like saying, ah, well, I saw them behind the walls with cords and things like that. You know, all the possibilities that they could have for the 14 months that this thing was going on, that they didn't actually slip and make a mistake.
Yeah, and people were just turning up to go to the house and experience stuff, and apparently most of the time they did. Something happened, wherever that was. And there was times where the kids did mess around, but that's just kids messing around.
Yeah.
Like, they walked in and found them messing around with the tape.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But that's what kids do. And I think as the phenomenon started to decrease, I think they started to, like, maybe act on it, start to put things on a little bit, because...
Well,
they're putting on a show, you know, and they don't want to disappoint people who come around. But I do think...
They probably have experiences where they had no show and it was disappointed, and people were making them feel worse because they're saying you're full of shit and that. So, in a way, there's a comfort in putting on the show to have people seeing it so that they know that it's still relevant. It's almost as if they're a part of it now.
Yeah.
So much a part of it that they have to actually... Isn't that Stockholm Syndrome? They're actually... They've fallen for their poltergeist captive, and they're actually... They're kind of trying to keep it going in a way. But maybe that was true. Who knows? Wow, you're not sure.
You just made... Because when you said fallen for your captive, you made me think of The Entity.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was full on.
That's a difficult film to watch.
It's again
allegedly based on a true story and documented case of a woman who has been repeatedly raped by a ghost.
Yeah, and the effects on that they really worked hard to kind of get a pressure on the body, that you can see handprints moving and the skin being pushed and pressed and twisted. Yeah. Really,
because the attacks are violent.
Yeah, and they really made sure that that's what they got.
Yeah, all the bruises all around the legs and stuff.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
But there's the one part, isn't there, where she's asleep and then it starts and then she has an orgasm and wakes up and realises what's happened.
Yeah,
and then she just starts screaming at whatever it is. And one thing freaked me out about watching The Entity at the end, you know, you get the what's happened after these events, and it says, like, the attacks, although have decreased in
intensity, yeah,
are still happening to this day. And I just thought, if that's real, fucking hell, that's horrible. You know,
but you must get to a point where you know that you can't escape it.
Yeah,
it's like having a...
Well, in the film, doesn't it, she goes to a friend's house and it all kicks off there, and a friend never believed her up until that point. And then like, I think small poltergeist activity happened there with things being pulled out of shelves and stuff.
And the light fittings are all...
Yeah, and then she's like, I'm sorry, I never believed you, you know.
It's bizarre.
It'd be a horrible thing, a situation where you just can't get away from it.
And that's when I think, you know, all the people who fake, the ones who do fake all this, all the crap and put it on TV and things like that.
Yeah.
You know, that they're really, it's like pretending that you were raped.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like,
and all, yeah.
Don't, you know, it's like, if this turns out to be a thing that is, sorry, is your Eddie Murphy suit a little bit itchy?
Yeah, it is. Sorry about that.
I'm sorry. I'm gonna change that chair next time. That's not fair on you.
No, it's okay.
Because you feel as though you can't move.
It's okay.
But yeah, I mean, it's just doing, you know, if it does turn out to be something that is true and these people are experiencing a lifetime of hurt and pain, then to be a person who actually pretended to do it just for just for publicity or money, shame on you guys.
Oh, absolutely. Jesus. It's awful. And that's the thing with the Anfield poltergeist. They've not
tried to make money out of it.
No, they haven't. And they're not rich.
Yeah, and as poltergeist activity tends to be, it happens for a certain amount of time for no reason, and then just stops for no reason.
Yes, yes.
Which seems to be what happened in this case.
I mean, the family left the house and somebody else had activity happening to them because he went in to get a clock radio.
Yeah, that was her brother, wasn't it? They'd gone on holiday and her brother went back.
Yeah, they were holidaying down at Essex.
Yeah. Now, this, I'm not sure I believe this guy.
Yeah, that sounds like, yeah, that there's somebody who's sitting at the table and...
then he had to get something, he said the clock, right? So he walks up and the door opens by itself.
And then he carries on.
He walks into the room, gets the clock, and the door shuts behind him.
Yeah.
He gets the clock, he sees the handle move, the door open again, and he walks through. I'm sorry, if I'm up that stairs and then the door just opens by itself, I'll buy you a new
clock.
And then
he has time on the way out to notice somebody sitting at the table.
Yeah.
And recognises exactly what they're wearing.
Yeah.
It's you know, towards the end, I think people were probably just fabricating their way through it just to get their name in the papers. I mean, I wonder how many stories he sold.
Well, that's interesting. I don't believe his account on things. And when you find Janet on top of the chest of drawers run about, the first person who was in that room was that brother.
Yeah.
Whether they heard the big bang, ran in there, and she was really high up there and don't know how she got there, and he just happens to be in the shot. Who knows, but...
Yeah.
I do believe something happened, which we should talk about Bill.
Bill. Yeah.
Right. Ooh, she's
cold, chill.
Yeah, straight. Jeez. Well, she started to... A voice started to come out of Janet.
Yeah.
And it was this really North London rough voice.
Right, yeah.
That came out. And it claimed to be someone called Bill. He used to live in the house.
Yeah.
And he'd gone blind.
Yeah, moments before he died.
Almost before he died, he'd gone blind. And he had a... Was it an embolism?
Embolism, a pop in his head.
Yeah, and he died. So, we'll play you a bit of Bill's greatest hits. just believe that this is coming out of a 13-year-old girl.
Yeah.
What happened to you when you died? Just before you died and just after you died.
Days before I died, I had a... I went blind. Then... I had an hemorrhage and I fell asleep and I died in a chair in the corner downstairs.
Bill, if you're there, would you answer me the following question? What have you done with Denise's 30p?
Headed down to the radio, downstairs.
Sorry, Bill, can you say that again, please?
Headed down to the radio, downstairs.
Right up, Bill, I'll go and look. Thanks so much. Why can't Janet fool you?
I'm invisible.
You're invisible? Why are you invisible?
So I'm a G-H-O-S-T.
So make of that what you will. I think that's quite compelling.
It is, especially when it was then... Not in the moment, because the book came out about the haunting.
Yeah.
And years later, I think one of the son or grandson of Bill read the book because he was interested in the area because that's where his grandfather or father used to live.
Yeah.
And he ended up corroborating that story.
Yeah.
About Bill's later years, about the fact that he died in the chair in the living room. He had an embolism and he was blinded by, you know, he was blind previous to his death. He was just going blind. So, you know, it's little details.
Yes, what's that about? What's all that about?
Yeah, I mean, it's like they say in the documentary, it is possible that could be common knowledge, that somehow there's a loophole where somebody actually did have that knowledge. It's possible. It's not impossible. It's not impossible.
She could have overheard it. And then it's in the subconscious, and then when this alter ego comes out.
Yeah.
But they did say that what's making the voice is a part of your vocal cords that we don't generally use.
Yeah, so they said.
So they said, yeah. And to talk like that for an extended period of time, your vocal cords can't
handle it.
Can't handle it. So, and you know,
brand new muscle, the back part of that, it's never used.
Yeah, you would lose your voice. So. Yeah,
it's odd.
And the voice is so. It sounds like an old man. It does sound like an old man from London.
Yeah.
It's weird, man.
And she doesn't seem to be the kind of girl who. I mean, she had this kind of a smirk on her face in that one video. And she seems to have this kind of a malevolent smirk on her face, as if she's, like, being naughty.
Yeah.
And you don't know where that's coming from. You don't trust it, but you don't know where it's coming from, so therefore you don't question it.
Mm.
You might not, you know, you can't trust it, but you don't question it.
That was a lesson on MC Hammer song. You can't trust it. You can't trust it.
Get out!
That'd be a vulgar display of power, Karis. Anyway.
Ooh. All the Exorcist.
What a gemstone.
I have the book right here.
I've never read the book. The cover used to scare me.
Not the cover, but I don't even know what the cover is.
Yeah, I don't know
what that is. What is that?
That's exactly what scared me.
I think it's the idol of a devil or something, but. God, I can smell history in here. Oh, I love the smell of old books.
Don't smell The Exorcist. You'll get possessed.
Just. Oh, yeah.
La plume de matin.
How long are you planning to stay in Reagan?
Until she rots and lies stinking in the earth.
Okay, so we kind of talked about the Enfield case.
Yeah.
We feel kind of like it's still open.
It is. It probably always will be. I don't think. Again, always the case for these things is you don't know what the truth is.
Yeah, I mean, people who weren't there can guess and make their own ideas. They seem to do it about moon landings and anything these days. It doesn't matter. But, you know, the truth is that, you know, supposedly there were things happening in this house. There was a family involved.
Mm.
That family are either... Yeah, it's honestly played with weird stuff going on. This is not, you know. But funnily enough, if this was any other podcast, we'd be annoyed. We're actually kind of like,
yeah, this is good.
This is okay. It works. There's a family involved. They're not going to change their story. They're not going to change now. I mean, they're set in their ways, and that's it. The people, other people who are involved, skeptics or otherwise. They're always going to be sticking to their own story.
Yeah.
They're not suddenly going to go, okay, hang on, okay, I'm going to confess now. You know, that doesn't happen. And, you know, we can either take it or leave it. It's up to us to decide.
Yeah.
But then, really, does it need to be decided? It's just a story about a haunted girl with a poltergeist in a house.
Yeah.
What can you do with that? About a movie.
Okay, I just watched the trailer.
Okay, first of all, the name of the film is not just The Enfield.
It's The Conjuring 2, The Enfield Poltergeist.
So it's a sequel. They made The Conjuring. What was The Conjuring about, the first film?
It was about the doll.
The doll.
Yeah.
The possessed doll,
yeah. It was the paranormal investigator went into Amityville.
Yeah, it was based on Warren.
Apparently they have this doll that if you ever take it out of the case, you know, it's a possessed doll and they have it in the little museum of antiquities. So.
And The Conjuring did all right at the box office with that.
I actually think The Conjuring is it's a decent film. It's a well-made film. I think James Wan, I think, directed it.
Yes.
And it's a decent film. It's a good effort. You know, there's ideas in there.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of not been done really that much. I mean, haunted dolls have been a kind of part and parcel of sequels in stupid films, but never actually been the idea of a film. The Conjuring and a doll fits together, okay.
Mm, yeah.
Fine. So then they want to make a sequel, but they don't want to do their own thing. They don't want to kind of figure out, you know, how they can take the paranormal genre forward. But what do they want to do instead? They want to take the Enfield
Yeah, right.
Poltergeist.
Yeah, but
the coin of the Enfield Poltergeist.
But yeah, right. So Enfield is a part of London. The actual place where this activity happened was like Council House.
So
the Trotcombe Conjure from the trailer is it's a mansion, a derelict mansion, in the middle of a fucking field, where they go in there and do a seance for some reason, and someone gets possessed, and all shit goes on, and it's just all that handheld camera. Got nothing to do with the fucking Enfield Poltergeist case.
There's nothing in there.
No,
there's
nothing.
Nothing. So
it's in a bit disgusting.
Yeah, I'm so glad you're there, because I was thinking, oh, do you know what? Andy, he must have seen this. I thought you'd seen it already.
When I saw 2016, it was coming out, I thought, there won't be a trailer yet, so yeah. I'm not bother looking for it. I just thought the trailers were fake.
Is that is real? That trailer, do you think? I don't...
It seems so.
Yeah, I mean... maybe. Let's start the vacuum cleaner. I need to find out, because this is bothering me. Because if these are clips taken from other films like The Haunting in Connecticut, or because it looks like a film that has been done to death already. This house is the Amityville house. This house is just simply another haunted house.
I don't know. I think that might be a fake trailer. You know?
Do you reckon?
There's no comments on it.
Oh, please let it be. I mean, the Conjuring 2.
Because there's another Enfield. One here.
This is a live investigation. That's not so live because we're putting it out 2 weeks later. Right, okay, unknown. Plot summary. There's no plot summary on the Internet Movie Database. The sequel is worth $300 million.
That's the plow $300 million into making it.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff on the message boards on the Internet Movie Database saying that you know, well, this is a kind of a messed up a whole true story. Still, a true story as the Enfield ghost story was a big thing in Britain, being covered by newspapers. I don't see why you say it shoots a horse in the face. It's as real as the first film, and in fact, it is the account of what happened. You son of a gun. How dare you? The Enfield Poltergeist was one of the most documented cases of poltergeist activity ever, and it's a fascinating story. But this is not what this trailer is about.
Right, The Conjuring 2, The Enfield Poltergeist, is an upcoming sequel to The Conjuring. Both Wilson and Farmiga, who portrayed Ed and Lorraine Warren in the original film, have been confirmed to reprise their role for this film.
So it's not going to be Enfield.
The film's release date has been pushed back to June 10, 2016. Plot. Back in the 1970s, the Warrens investigated claims of demonic possession from a pair of sisters in Enfield, England. Over the course of the investigation, the Warrens witnessed levitation, dematerialization, and had conversation with the demon itself. I did not know. They had nothing to do.
No.
The Warrens had nothing to do with the
Because in America, the Warrens are gold. They are a part of the mythology now. They were in The Haunting in Connecticut, The Conjuring.
Right. The film was given an early release date of October 23rd, 2015. A close friend of the real Lorraine Warren, who discussed the upcoming film with her, described it as follows. The case file they are looking at in the late 70s centres on two sisters in Enfield, England, who were allegedly possessed. Warren said she personally saw them levitate and even saw one of the sisters dematerialise in front of her, only to be found 20 minutes later stuffed into an oversized fuse box, contorted in such an unnatural way that they couldn't have replicated it if they tried. She also said that the demon spoke directly to her husband on many occasions. Warren cited this case as one of the most terrifying experiences of her career. Let's call it what it is, a blatant lie.
Wow.
Out of the documentaries we've watched in Enfield Poltergeist, yes. The Warrens were never brought up at all. Ever go in there.
They wouldn't have gone. That's rubbish. Enfield Poltergeist, there's someone who said to somebody called Patrick Wilson, there's actually a thing on the Enfield Poltergeist on Twitter. You need to understand that The Conjuring 2 Enfield Poltergeist will not be coming out in the UK without I'll say so.
Okay.
That's like a strong word. Currently fighting trademark infringement from New Line Cinema. That's there's a whole thing, a demand that they're trying to basically somebody who is obviously who gets what we're talking about. Yeah. They've sent an email to New Line Cinema and they're trying to kind of say, what the heck do you think you're doing? They're not happy. They've got some photographs of letters that they've sent they're trying to challenge it. And I think this is one of those moments in our podcast where the historical values of a truly British institution such as the Enfield Poltergeist.
Yeah, because obviously it was huge. It made front page headlines, the Enfield Poltergeist.
There's no way they can get away with this. Call it the Enfield Poltergeist. It's just, okay, let's look at it at face value. There's nothing in the film about the Enfield Poltergeist. They're just using the name.
Yeah.
That's the only thing that is ringing true, is the name.
Yeah, but they're using the name to
promote.
Yeah, because it's such a big, widely reported case.
This is going to be a blog.
So they're so they're raping that name in order to further, just to make more money.
This is the first podcast of outrage.
Fuck me, that's disgusting.
Yeah. I saw the trailer last night and I thought, that's not Enfield. And I just couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. And I thought, well, surely that this is, you know, I didn't think about the possibility that it was a fake. I just thought that surely this can't be the Enfield that we're thinking about. But it's, you know.
It's not the Enfield we're thinking about, and don't call me Shirley. That's quite disgusting. It really is.
Yeah, I'd like to know what. I mean, I'm.
Why are we surprised? It's not like they've not done it before.
No, have they done this before?
What's the Anneliese? What was her name?
Oh yeah, the Anneliese.
Anneliese Michel.
Yeah, they did that for. Was it the Exorcism of Emily Rose?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which couldn't have been further from the truth.
Yeah, so they faked an Emily Rose type character and just put the template of the Anneliese story and put it on there.
Yeah, because I find the Anneliese Michel story truly disturbing.
Yeah, especially when you see that picture of her in school.
She's so pretty. Looks like such a pretty happy girl.
Yeah, and all of a sudden there's this mess of a thing that barely resembles a girl.
No! Ich bin Error! Ich bin der Dritte im Bunde!
Right, when she was 16, she experienced epileptic seizures.
Yes.
And was diagnosed with temporal lobe epilepsy. So she was given drugs to help with it. Now, bear in mind, this was, in the 70s again.
Yeah. Was it 73, 74?
76 when she died.
Okay, so how long had it been going on for? I mean, it seemed like she was quite a mess.
I mean,
that's years of...
Well, what we know now about psychiatric disorders is...
Yeah.
You know, you can have... I know someone who is schizophrenic and claims to have written Mr. Tambourine Man. You know what I mean? And I mean, so... But what's disgusting about this case is she appears to have been just treated barbarically. Where the priest did an exorcism on her. Like, basically, the drugs didn't work, did they? And she started to get worse and she was violent. And she was, like, disfiguring herself. She and then started to speak in tongues and, like, which I think is disturbing. It's really
thing is,
really
do you know what's really, really strange? And do you know what it made me think of? The gurglings and the mumblings of a baby. But then put it to kind of a language.
And then someone who's in pain screaming it. Often it's, you, funnily you mention like that, because
this primitive, there's something primitive about it. Yeah,
the person, it's not the schizophrenic person, but I know a person who struggles a little bit, and when he's talking incessantly about random things, and you know, it reminds me of my daughter, who's six, but who can sing a song for 4 hours straight, the same song over and over again. You take that and put it into the body of a 26-year-old, all of a sudden it becomes this weird thing.
Look at dementia. I mean, what does dementia do? It makes people who are in their senior years think that their mother needs to pick them up from school.
Yeah.
That's a mental condition that is true, and it is present, and it's heartbreaking. Because, you know, you've got people who have lived a life already, have done amazing things, and all of a sudden they're back to square one again, being like a child. It's bizarre.
So you've got this poor girl who, thank God that the priests who did it, they got charged with negligent homicide. She was dehydrated, malnutrition had set in.
Yeah,
no wonder her skin was fading away and stuff, because she wasn't being fed.
They were trying to seize the demon, and they're thinking that the only way they can do that is by destroying the flesh, the body. They put no value on her whatsoever as a person, as a human being. They were all about the demon.
Yeah, and then they killed her, and then Hollywood goes, what a nice way to make some money. Let's make a film up. Which actually is quite scary, Emily Rose.
It is, but then, you know, it's... The Exorcism of Emily Rose. I'm so glad we don't have any relatives with that name. Oh, hang on.
Oh, God.
We do. Sorry, Emily Rose. It's this kind of thing that does wind you. I mean, and it's not about being pompous and British either. This is about just... It's a principle. The Enfield Poltergeist is a specific story.
Yeah, and so was it's Anneliese Michels.
It's like Into the Woods, stealing all these other fables and putting it into one big fable and saying, this is now American. This is American.
Yeah.
And I know it sounds like I'm not being anti-American, I'm not being anti-anything. I'm just kind of being... Either way, it doesn't matter which way. I mean, if we steal from you, you steal from us, or if anybody steals from anybody, it's still a theft. But it's not stealing, it's actually just twisting it and disowning it and creating something out of it that is just completely unrecognisable.
Yeah, I suppose the thing you've got with the Exorcism of Emily Rose is they called her Emily Rose, so it's loosely based on something that actually happened.
Somebody else.
But to call The Conjuring the Enfield Poltergeist, and then they have nothing really to do with the Enfield Poltergeist.
Yeah, I might as well just call it The Conjuring the Loch Ness Monster and just have a kid wading in a pool going, I'm going to die!
Yeah, well, it seems like this film is so far removed from the actual Enfield Poltergeist case, they could have called it The Conjuring 2 Beverly Hills Cop 4 and then just make it about a possession.
Well, they could have called it Amityville, you know, and it would have been closer to the truth.
It would have been.
Would have been. This is quite a passionate plea to New Line Cinema. Don't! Just don't!
But they will. They'll make money out of it.
Because Disney owns New Line Cinema, don't they?
Do
they?
They don't really own everything. Along with our souls.
Into the woods. Well, yeah, we don't want to get on our high horse too much. I mean, there's time enough for The Conjuring to be ripped apart.
Which we will when it comes out.
Keep on saying, look, this is the Enfield Poltergeist.
Or if you release
it... What is it you're making?
Yeah, well, if you release it in cinema called The Enfield Poltergeist, but when it's released here, call it something different. They do it all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
Just call it The Conjuring 2.
Yeah, you don't need to actually have anything else at the end there. Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's just... But from what it looks like, if you actually just look at the trailer, forget the title, forget what we're thinking about it, The Conjuring 2, the trailer, what is in that trailer that says anything new or fresh about the genre of haunted house horror?
Nothing. In fact, every image, if that is actually the trailer to
it... It is, yeah.
Every image in that is cliched.
Yeah, it's just...
You got the handheld night vision camera...
Yeah, just for about a millisecond.
Yeah, you've got the possessed woman. You've seen that a million times now.
It's just, it's just too much, isn't it?
The one film that really did that did that justice, and we've touched upon in previous podcasts, is Urban Ghost Story.
Yeah, and that was a low-budget film, guerrilla filmmaker, Chris Jones, and his wife, girlfriend, wife. And yeah, it's a perfect film. It's not available on DVD. I think it is available on DVD.
Yeah, I think
we need to get that. We need to get the Chris Jones stuff, White Angel. White Angel is pretty much a film about, it's almost like the Fred West Murders, that one. That's pretty freaky.
Oh, is it?
Hannibal slash...
Bloody hell, Billy Boyd was in it. He was a hobbit.
Great, yeah. But Urban Ghost Story, I actually have a postcard as well. I had the video, but I left the country and somebody sold all my stuff to a travelling troupe.
Oh, I had that film. It wasn't that cover, but I had the film.
Yeah. And it's such an amazing coincidence that we've both seen a film that nobody's watched. You ask me, ask anybody if they've seen Urban Ghost Story by Chris Jones, and they're like, no.
And it's because it sort of, I think they loosely base some of the activity in that film on the Enfield Poltergeist.
Possibly, yes.
Because with the cabinet moving and things like that, you can buy it for £1.77 off eBay.
Oh, go.
I'm going to buy it on a podcast.
We're doing it right now.
This is exciting.
This is exciting. we're doing everything that we shouldn't be doing on a podcast. Stopping and starting. eating. But, yeah. We're just having fun. We own our podcast.
Yeah, this is our thing. If you don't get
your own podcast.
Yeah. £1.77.
£1.77, that's a steal.
Setting up purchase. This is exciting. Pay now.
Yes. He's paying. Oh my gosh. Here we go. He's paying. It's happening.
Let me pay. Why didn't you let me pay?
Oh no. It's always at the 11th hour. It's just like the tension.
Please log into your PayPal account.
Can I just ask a question while you're doing this?
Yeah.
What would Merkel Bay do if he was ordering this on eBay? If he was ordering a DVD on eBay? Well, Mark Wahlberg.
You have requested an outdated version of PayPal. This error often results from the use of bookmarks.
I would actually be happier if Michael Bay had the original Enfield story rather than having The Conjuring 2.
Would you?
I would be happy with his attempt. Because I know it would be better than that, right? It'll be unique. It'll be uniquely explosive.
Because I think if Michael Bay did the Enfield Poltergeist, it'd be more like The Entity.
Yes, but I can't get you up with Megan Fox.
Yeah, Megan Fox will be in there. She'll be having sex.
She'll be enjoying it a lot more than the actual Entity woman.
Yeah. It won't be a rape though. Yeah, it'll be she's falling in love with this ghost. The ghost will be Mark Wahlberg.
And they'll be doing it at high speed on planes and anything that moves. Not in a house. It'll be on vehicles.
The Enfield Poltergeist that take over a car and you have to have a car chase while the ghost is driving the car behind it.
The car will be a Ford Enfield. It'll be a Ford Enfield, yeah. That'll be the vehicle that the whole story will be set on. It's a vehicle.
But actually, the Enfield Poltergeist inspired a unique TV event in Britain.
It did, yes. Oh,
Ghostwatch,
and if you're able to, if you've heard of YouTube, then you can actually watch the whole thing. It's called Ghostwatch. It's by the BBC, and it is a fake document. No, it's a drama. It's a drama.
Yeah,
a dramatization of a documentary that has very similar. In fact, that is a perfect Conjuring 2. Right there, if they'd have done that.
Exactly. They don't have to do Conjuring 2, the Enfield Poltergeist, because it's been done.
Yeah,
for British TV.
For British TV. And this is a drama that was put out in 1992.
Yeah. I like how they've advertised Urban Ghost Story. Very good DVD. I'm sold. I want that.
I want a very good DVD.
Pay for it.
Put that on my poster. For stand-up. Very good DVD. So Ghostwatch was 1992. They're calling it a TV movie. Which is interesting. It's got Michael Parkinson. Michael Parkinson in America would be Charlie Rose.
Perhaps. I would imagine if Michael Parkinson went to America, he'd still be the same person, though.
Like Piers Morgan. Morgan kind of thing, yeah?
Yeah, but you don't want to kill him.
Well, yeah, I do, actually, because, he's a very, very,
Parkinson's an actual treasure. He's a great guy.
I have issues with Sun Life. That's the only thing I have issues with.
I'm with you on that.
Every single week I get a Sun Life brochure, and it's basically once you hit the age of 50, you can take out a life policy, life insurance. I'm 30 freaking 4, and I've been receiving this mail for about 10, 15 years.
Yeah.
Trees are dying quicker than I am. So that's ridiculous. But anyway, he's the host. He's kind of like what do you call it? The reliable relator? Reliable narrator?
Presenter. It's a mock TV show where they're allegedly going into a haunted house and they're going to film and see if anything happens. And it's very real time, realistic.
It was all live in one night, yeah.
It was all live, yeah. And I'm not sure people knew at the time when it first aired that it was completely faked.
It is funny, yes.
Done really well.
It was done really well from that, but for the time, it was definitely of the time. I mean, if you watch it now, you can kind of tell that it's, you've seen better dramatizations.
Yeah, but hindsight is 20/20.
Oh,
if you watch it for the first time now, you'd still be thinking, oh God, they're going into a haunted house. This will be interesting. And shit kicks off.
I'll show it to Aspen, and I won't tell him.
Don't tell him.
Yeah, I'll test that out when he's 4.
Tell him he's adopted too, and if he doesn't do the right thing, you're sending him back to Syria.
The programme you're about to watch is a unique live investigation of the supernatural. It contains material which some viewers may find to be disturbing. No creaking gates, no gothic towers, no shuttered windows. Yet for the past 10 months, this house has been the focus of an astonishing barrage of supernatural activity.
What you're about to watch was made for TV.
And I just thought it was the most exciting and sensational idea.
None of us had the slightest premonition of what was going to happen.
And she told me the idea of it being sort of kind of War of the Worlds-y.
I mean, I remember being terrified when this bloody great big red blotch appeared in the studio.
Now, the whole reaction from within the BBC, particularly the press department, will be different. They would be dancing with joy.
And I'll bet you there are people who are out there writing and directing stuff now as a direct consequence of that show.
As a director, when the boat leaves the harbour, you know, you just think, is it going to float? And that's all you want to know is it going to float? Is someone going to see it?
So Michael Parkinson is an in-studio host, and he kind of connects with the outside broadcast, which is set at this house.
And the casting's genius, because Parky is such a trusted guy at the time.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like I say, he was a national treasure. He interviews the big guys, the big names, so for him to be doing this...
Yeah, yeah.
He trusted it, you know.
Exactly, and I think he knew that he was just having going to have fun with this.
Yeah.
And out of all of them, he did put on the best version of himself.
Yeah, he did.
He was able to act himself very well. But in the house, you had famous people such as Mike Smith. It was a DJ. He used to be a DJ in the 80s.
Okay.
He's married to Sarah Green. He was married to Sarah
Green. Oh, I know what you mean, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Sarah Green is the... she used to be a children's television presenter. So she kind of, pulls in that sense of innocence and... she has that, quality that, you can relate to, you feel safe with. And then you got Craig Charles. If you watch Red Dwarf, and I know it's one of those things that they have all around the world now. I mean, everybody knows
Red Dwarf. So they should. Red Dwarf is fantastic.
Craig Charles is the crazy vindaloo-eating scumbag with dreadlocks who everybody loves. And he's kind of like the light entertainment value.
Well, he plays it really well, because he wasn't taking it seriously, was he?
No.
until spooky, yeah, things kick off, you know.
Yeah, and the idea is that they're visiting one family for one Halloween special night, and this family have been terrorized by a poltergeist and ghost activity from which that emanates from underneath the stairs and has kind of like messed the rooms up. Things have exploded, you know, you name it, the typical kind of house.
Yeah.
Anything that you see in the Enfield poltergeist is pretty much what you'll see in Ghostwatch.
They
kind of keep it light to begin with. It's like there's apple bobbing and it's Halloween themed, and the mother kind of cries. That's normal for Halloween. But she's a good actress, but you can still tell that she's an actress. The two girls were actually sisters.
Oh, were they? Right.
Yeah, and
because it's interesting to say it was actually released on Halloween, wasn't it?
Exactly. That was it. It was all live.
It wasn't live.
It was pre-recorded. It was pre-recorded, but it was. It gave the impression of live, because you were still able. They still had the phone number at the bottom of the screen that you could call in, and they actually had fake call-ins from people who. When things did start to kick off, they themselves were experiencing activity in their house, and someone's glass table shattered, and they were terrified. And and those kind of elements, those unseen elements, were quite frightening at the time. I mean, it was one thing that you kind of feel insulted because you find out it was fake, but at the time, it really did scare.
It did, up to a point when things started happening in the studio and all hell's breaking loose there. Yeah. Then you start thinking, all right, okay.
Yeah, it was only when Michael Parkinson started to get possessed and the studio started to have things spinning around, and then he started to go
round and round, round, the garden like a teddy bear.
Teddy bear.
Oh.
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 Oh. And that was it.
Yeah,
and then he came
all over Sarah Green.
But I was watching it last night because I was watching it in silence because Catherine was in here with Aspen, and looking at Sarah Green, she was quite an attractive woman.
She was, yeah.
Even though as a kid I didn't feel it because she was an older woman, so it would have been wrong.
When did that stop any members of the BBC?
So yeah, I mean, it was a fun value for money entertainment program that rustled up. The word rustle keeps to keep coming into.
Rustled up's another good comedian.
A lot of controversy, and people rang in to
complain
because they weren't told that it was a drama, even though the Radio Times clearly says this one-off drama. It even has a cast list of you know, people, you know, presenter was playing himself, and then the actual people in the house were actually.
Yeah, well, it says here that they received 30,000 calls in a single hour.
Yeah, of complaint, because
that's,
you know,
amazing.
And Anne Robinson, if you know Anne Robinson from The Weakest Link, she used to have a popular program that was a kind of a community consumer program where people were able to complain about television. You know, British people like to complain a lot.
Yeah.
I'm all up for it. But you know, if you can play a few of those letters that came into Points of View, of complaint, they're hilarious. They are brilliant, so let's hear a couple of those now.
Hello and good evening. And not since Paul Daniels looked as if he'd breathed his last in a seal vault, apparently crushed to death 6 Halloweens ago, terribly sad, has there been such a fuss.
Ghostwatch. My 11-year-old son was left shaking and physically sick after 10 minutes. Prior warning should have been given, so we had some idea of what was to come.
And?
The BBC should be locked up for such a prank. I guessed halfway through it was a hoax, but people do live in haunted houses. They're frightened enough without being ridiculed by Michael Parkinson.
Or?
I have a helpline for people in distress, and I received over 300 calls. In fact, I thought Ghostwatch was brilliant, but it was introduced as a drama, and many of the people I helped did not understand that drama means fiction.
And thanks to Joe Soton of Staffordshire for that call, because it is, you could say, at the heart of the matter. Anyway, for those who are busy out tricking and treating or listening to Radio 3, Ghostwatch was advertised in the Radio Times, TV Times, etc. as
a Screen One special drama for Halloween by Stephen Volk, starring Michael Parkinson, Sarah Green,
etc., etc., followed by a brief resume which ended
BBC TV turns the camera on ghoulies, ghosties, and things that go bump in the night.
And then there was a cast list like this. Not everybody, or even nearly everybody, of course, gets a Radio Times or TV Times. Ghostwatch kicked off at 9:25 with Screen One credits and then switched to Michael Parkinson in a studio with Dr., well, specifically
Dr. Lynn Pascoe, played by Gillian Bevan.
And Mike Smith, who played himself. Here's Parky setting the scene with Sarah Green, also playing herself, and the Early family. They, incidentally, played by
Brid Brennan, Michelle Wesson, and Cherise Wesson.
And who were builders living in a haunted house in Fox Hill Drive, North Holt, where at this particular point, well, not a lot is happening.
While we search for that piece of tape, let's find out what Sarah's up to.
Sarah, did you hear that? Somebody thinks they've seen a presence in the house.
Today?
Yeah, you've not noticed anything this evening, have you?
No, nothing to report from here yet, except how absolutely useless I am at apple bobbing.
Well, it doesn't look much like a Screen One, but hardly the sort of stuff to frighten the cat. And it ambled on in this vein for the first 40-odd minutes, until things did start to happen. Here's Sarah again, and Suzanne Early now sounding completely different.
I don't know what's going on. Can you hear this? Smithy? Michael? Dr. Pascoe? There are incredible noises coming from the walls. And from the ceiling.
Susie.
Stop it! Stop it, Susie!
And hand up those who thought Sarah Green was acting. No, never mind that question. Did it look convincing?
Okay, I'm not ashamed to admit it. Ghostwatch totally fooled me and scared me half to death. I've never been so terrified in my whole life.
Says Linda Beach of Liverpool and
absolutely brilliant.
Says Richard Stewart of Brentwood.
My wife and I sat riveted to our seat, believing it was all truly happening. I'm so pleased we didn't spoil the illusion in advance by looking in the Radio Times and realising it was a spoof.
Or, if you prefer, MP Parker of Dorset.
An arrogant and clumsy dissection of the paranormal, prejudiced for the trivial purpose of providing family entertainment. A sick joke.
And for the record, there were on the night a total of 835 calls to the duty office. 382 viewers rang to say it was an insult to their intelligence, 275 thought it in poor taste, another 62 just had a general moan, and 116 rang to say they thoroughly enjoyed it. No one congratulated Sarah Green on her acting, but perhaps they were too busy worrying if she'd gone missing forever in the cupboard under the stairs.
That's it, exactly.
Yeah,
and they put the nail on the donkey. They pinned the tail on the donkey right there.
Cruelty to donkey.
The fact that it was actually a drama and everybody took it seriously, is because when you're a filmmaker, if you're a person who kind of follows television and film, when you see the word drama, you know it's fiction.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
But if you are somebody at home who is a layman who just gets the Radio Times and says, "Oh, this is Ghostwatch," it's a, you know. It seems live to me.
If you were as uneducated as the people in Enfield Poltergeist case.
Yeah.
Full circle, my friends.
Yeah.
Boom.
Exactly. And obviously, you know, the whole nation was just in uproar. And the rest of us were just sitting there going, oh...
I like how that woman said that the BBC should be locked up, like the entire industry.
Yes! Just get them all! And David Attenborough as well, you know, stop making those animal programmes, just lock him up.
Sick of whales.
You know, poor Philip Schofield gets released, like, last year, and he's like this white-haired, thin, scrawny-looking... Oh.
Mm.
Kind of is.
Like Paul McCartney, Schofield died. And he's been replaced by an imposter.
Yeah? Because there was a moment, wasn't there, when he was dyed and... No, his hair was dyed.
Yeah, that was it. And then no longer.
But because somebody accidentally let it slip that Philip Schofield died, they had to finish the sentence. His hair! And that was how they covered it up.
Yeah, that's
conspiracy. Oh, I love that
BBC
idea.
Covering things up, tell you what.
No, it's
they wouldn't do that, would they?
All new.
Yeah.
So there we have it, folks. Three interesting cases, one being a drama and two being Oh, we didn't even talk about Ghosts of the Underground.
It's boring anyway.
I sent you a text message saying I actually remember it being a lot more interesting.
Yeah, I started watching it and I was just like...
Yeah, more interesting. And the people saying, well, I was on a train and then I saw I took a photograph. I didn't think anything of it at the time. But when I got the photograph developed, there was a picture of a man in an electric chair. And it's like... Yeah, and it looked just like the Madame Tussauds electric chair. And I'm like, could it be a poster? Could it be a double exposure? Did you actually go to the wax museum? Did somebody with the camera have a double exposure? I mean, come on, it's a bit spooky, don't you think?
Let's end then.
Yeah, with
what do you think of ghosts? Are you on board with it? Are you on the fence?
That's a good question.
Do you think there are such things as ghosts?
I'm on the fence. I mean, I'd like to think. I mean, there's a comfort, right, about knowing that there's things out there. I mean, people kind of argue about the idea that if people turn to ghosts, then there would be ghosts everywhere.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, well, that's not necessarily true. It could just be the energy is... I think that there's something to do with energy. I know that much. And I think that maybe that if they all were appearing, then there must be some sort of a source of energy that's pulling them to become seen.
Yeah, because there's theories like Stone Tape Theory, where the actual fabric of buildings record time.
Yeah.
So maybe in 100 years from now, there's someone else living in this house, and all of a sudden you just see us two doing a podcast, and then we're gone, and think, oh God, we're haunted. You're not haunted. No. It's just a replay of an event that just happens to be recorded in the fabric of a building.
I kind of had this this idea of the shamanism thing, that the possibility that objects have memory, and that the most severe disruption to a memory of an object, be it a slam against the wall, violent acts. I mean, people seem to think that they see ghosts who experience violent things to them. Well, if say this cup, this Leonard Nimoy
cup.
I can't use that. This book here. Okay, this book.
Leonard Nimoy again.
I've got more books on Leonard Nimoy. Okay. Oh, you know what? This is perfect. Here we go. I've got a novel of Poltergeist in my hand.
Oh right. Okay. Yes, he has. Okay,
I do, and I'll take a picture and I'll prove it. God, that smells gorgeous.
That's me. Not me.
I'm sniffing the book. Okay.
There you go.
Okay, that's proof that I'm holding. But right, imagine this book has memory.
Yeah.
Okay. If I'm going to die in a horrific way, in relation to this book, my body would be falling on it and slam against it.
Right.
Imagine that. Imagine that impact. Yeah. Bang. That book has never had anything like that in its existence as matter. That book has never experienced that kind of an impact before.
Okay.
So therefore, it's going to be imprinted on its memory. That the molecules have kind of like just rebounded, bounced, okay, and So my idea is that this book, at any time of there being an impact or something that resonates with that feeling that book just experienced, could easily just suddenly manifest this energy that brings a vision of me collapsing to the floor, or slamming the book against somebody's head, or whatever the object. That I think that people see things maybe because of a high impact energy. That there's some sort of release of an energy, and when it's.
I remember reading a story of a woman walking down the street and seeing a man dressed in like World War Army, regalia sort of thing, and kissing this girl and just in an embrace, and as she walked up to him, they just disappeared.
Yeah.
Now that could have been him going to war, and that's the last time they ever saw each other. And such an emotional moment.
Emotions,
have just manifested itself.
Yeah, I mean, and that could have come from her as much as it came from that memory. I mean, if they were pressed against the wall, would that wall have that memory? Can objects absorb emotions? Has that ever been looked at as a thing?
Who knows? There's also, if we talk about like different dimensions, We vibrate at a certain frequency. That's how I can see you, because you're vibrating and I'm vibrating and everything's vibrating. So what if another frequency vibrates at a higher?
Yeah.
And that so there's an entire other life living right next to us, but we can't see it because it's on a higher vibration. Yeah. But when we're scared, perhaps we vibrate a little bit quicker. And at times when we're scared, and somehow you can sometimes tap into it and you see things.
Genius,
going
yeah.
into another dimension.
That's it, yeah. I mean, that's...
That was a theory I always had when I was doing the ghost stuff.
Yeah, exactly. So there's kind of like different things, and it's all... I think it's all to do with energy.
Yeah.
I don't think it's anything to do with luck or... I don't think science can bring anything to it unless they're really working on...
I don't think it's got anything to do with dead people coming back.
No, it's not dead people.
I don't
people.
Think that.
No.
You know. Like, we were talking about Amityville.
Yeah.
If anything ever did happen in there, I mean, someone violently shooting his entire family, that would create some serious energy.
Yeah, absolutely.
So why not things happen
yeah.
because of that? It's just yeah. we're just looking at it from a different perspective.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. And it's purely because the human energy is specific, like DNA.
Yeah, yeah.
That... We can create in our minds anything. I mean, if you can remember the smell from childhood, why can't you visualize a person, a complete person, through an energy frequency?
Yeah.
I mean, it's powerful stuff, and we just haven't. We haven't even tapped it. We don't even know.
No. And there's pareidolia as well, and that's
yeah,
where your brain only takes so much. Like, your eyes take in, say, 30-40%, and then your brain says, this is what it is.
Yes.
And makes
yeah.
it up for you. So you walk into a room. It happened to me once at Sheffield Fire and Police Museum. I walked into a room and I saw about a 7 foot tall guy wearing like a poncho, like Bruce Willis did in Unbreakable.
Right, yeah.
His eyes looked right at me. And I walked into the room, was dark, it was only lit up by the viewfinder of the camcorder.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I looked at him and he looked at me and I didn't shit myself and I ran out.
Yeah, yeah.
A few minutes later, I gathered myself up and walked in. This time I switched the light on, and then all it was a wardrobe that had a suitcase on top of it.
Yeah.
So the wardrobe was like a canvas wardrobe,
yeah.
and the suitcase, conceivably in the dark, looked like two eyes and a mouth. And my brain, I walked in, I saw that.
It filled in the rest
yeah,
of it.
Yeah, my brain
yeah.
says, this is what it is, it's a man, because that's what your brain expects to see.
Yeah, yeah,
it
yeah,
thinks
yeah.
the most rational thing it would be is a person. There he is, and that's what you see.
Is it
but that's
that
not
simple?
What was there.
Yeah, it's that simple.
But that might be in some cases.
Yeah,
and then when
yeah.
we talk about poltergeist activity, that could actually be coming from a person.
Yes.
Manifesting that. We don't know what we can do with our brains. Yet.
Yeah, and I just don't think that researchers these days, I mean, there seems to be no focus. They obsess about having things that they can hold. And then they record stuff, they listen to it, and they think, oh wow, did you hear that? Let's
yeah.
not act on this. Let's just store it on the computer, let everybody hear it, and then just go somewhere else. They don't seem to have a clue about how to actually... The words investigation, the words research,
yeah.
it's kind of become a jumble of horseshit that has no meaning anymore.
What used to make me laugh, I'm not naming any
yeah.
TV shows, but I'm most haunted. No, like, say they'll be like, is there anybody there? You know, make two knocks if you're there. Oh my God, did you hear that? It was two knocks, it was two knocks, oh my God. If I was a ghost, I'd just be like, you're trying to get a conversation going with
yeah.
me, and then every time I try and talk back to you, you're freaking out. Fuck off, I'm not going to talk to you.
Exactly, yeah. And
yeah.
It's odd that for generations people have been watching this stuff, and they kind of think that they're watching something that is a part of I don't know, do people watch these shows and think this is what they're doing, this is the research into ghosts, this is what people are out there. I'm so glad they're out there trying to figure out if ghosts exist.
Yeah.
I'm so happy that there's so many people out there doing it, but they're not. Nobody's doing anything. Nobody.
No.
They're not.
It's an entertainment program, that's
yeah.
what they are. They're there to entertain you. They're not there to seriously prove or disprove the existence of ghosts.
Nothing.
They're there to just say, oh, look, if I was a ghost, I wouldn't throw things at people. You know what I mean? I wouldn't throw stones at people.
Unless it was an accidental ricochet of something else.
Well, yeah, but someone's like talking to me. The way I'm going to tell you that I'm present in this room is I'm going to throw a stone at your face.
Yeah, it's not.
What happens between life and death that makes you turn into a dickhead? You know what I mean?
Exactly.
It makes no sense.
Yeah. So. It depends on where you're actually investigating, but that's another thing. I mean, it seems as though that the behaviour and the nature of ghosts is the same no matter where you go. If it's a schoolroom, a prison, or an actual place, or a hospital, or whatever,
yeah.
It seems as though they all seem to act like dickheads, like you say.
Yeah. But one thing before we end that we didn't discuss when we talked about the Amityville case.
Yeah.
The picture of that boy.
Yeah. Oh, that was the that picture.
Yeah. What's your takes on that? Because they had several cameras, didn't they, all around the house, and that one was just taking pictures. On like what every few minutes.
It's spooky because you can't. I mean, pareidolia is supposed to happen in the moment in the eye of the beholder. It's not like something that a camera can make. But yeah, it is.
And that does look like a boy looking around the corner at the camera.
That picture unnerves me. Actually, makes me feel.
Same with me.
Yeah, and out of all of them, because it can't be explained. It's not something that. But to me, I don't want things to, because there's so many people out there faking it. You almost don't want to even say that any photograph is worth looking at, because you just can't tell anymore.
Mm.
But that. It's of the time, it's of the moment, it's freaky as hell.
Yeah.
Out of all of them, and it's probably the most compelling.
Yeah.
Definitely.
I think that's the best picture of an alleged haunting I've ever seen.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, it just stirs. I mean, I think, especially now that I've got a little boy.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I think that, you know, when I see that, all of a sudden I just have this emotional response. I had to look away. It's weird.
Well,
that's it.
It's going to take us forever to finish this, but...
We're going to do it.
But going into my personal life, because I've been... I watched the documentary about the Enfield Poltergeist.
Yeah.
So I'm heightened now. And then I'd looked into that Anneliese girl, which just disturbed me because of what they did to a poor little girl.
You got the German.
Yeah, the German, who clearly has some serious issues.
Yeah.
I don't think she was possessed. I think it is a mental illness. It's a state of mind, you know.
Yeah, and they were just...
But River has this bookcase and has these two drawers in it.
Okay.
And they're always open. Always. I'll shut them. I'll go out the room. River might have been in there playing, and it's something River would do to keep opening them to wind me up. But last night, it's the truth. I wasn't going to talk about it, but I am doing that. Is I went into the bedroom to put her to bed, and the drawers were open, so I shut them, and I went, she's in bed, we read a book, and then, as I was walking out, you have to go round the bed, and it's right next to him, and the drawers were open again, and I just thought, River could have opened them when I weren't looking, but because I've been looking at all this shit, I was thinking, what if, so I just shut them again, and they weren't open this morning. But when I give River a kiss and a hug, and I was just about to leave, and she keeps opening her door all the time, and I'm trying to tell her, you know, don't stop opening your door, because we could be watching like a horror film downstairs. I don't want to hear any of that. And she didn't, but I was expecting her to say, because she said, well, when I look at the door, Dad, and I thought she was going to say, it just keeps opening. She didn't say that though. She just said, she likes to have the door open so she can look outside, she can look at the landing. And the staircase, which to me is weirder, because if you're going to see a ghost, you'd see it go past the landing or something. That's not the way River thinks. She's six, but that's the way I think as a 36-year-old.
Yeah, who's
man.
Conditioned by everything that's...
But because of this drawer issue they keep opening, and that, I just expected her to say, the door just keeps opening, Dad. And I just then expected to say, well, you're going to be living in your bedroom with Mum and Dad until you're 20. But didn't happen.
It's odd, isn't it? Yeah, I mean...
It is. Would I be even thinking that if I hadn't been doing this for a week, looking at all these haunted cases?
I think it does influence. There is a lot of, you know, it's like that feeling of looking at that picture then. You know, if it was a week ago, 2 weeks ago, I probably would have feeling a little bit more comfortable about it.
But looking at that picture makes you feel like I'm looking out that doorway now. Those banisters look like the banisters that are in the picture.
True, yeah.
And it's like...
Because it's so relevant and so specific.
And it sort of gets you on a primal level.
Yeah, yeah. It's It makes you feel weird.
Yeah.
And that's kind of how I've never actually... This is one heck of a podcast, an emotional roller coaster ride.
I know.
We had dinner. That was nice. The phone keeps on ringing. But yeah, I mean the rage about Conjuring, we kind of like had an emotional roller coaster ride already.
Been through the ringer.
What are we gonna do now?
Get the phone. It's gone off. I feel weird.
Do you feel? Yeah.
A little bit. Do you?
I think there's an energy that we were playing off at the moment. I think we ought to just keep recording for a few more minutes just in case.
Is there anybody there?
Yeah, well, we're recording.
Imagine playing this back and then hearing stuff. There's a reservoir on the other side of Manchester. There's a village there, and it's really freaky. We've had a few warm days and the water's receded a little bit. You can see the steeple of a church coming out of the water. Scuba divers go down there and look through the village and stuff.
That's crazy.
Yeah, they moved. They basically removed the entire village so they could just flood it and use it as a reservoir.
That was actually a story in The Vicar of Dibley, of all things.
Really?
I hate to bring that up, but yeah, I mean, that was actually, they wanted to flood Dibley, and they had a little model and they just said that, yeah, and they had to protest and had Dawn French chained to railings.
I remember being chained to a railing.
That was the protest because of the flooding. But yeah, I mean, there is a weird feeling, and it's funny because when we start talking about all this kind of stuff, it does make me fascinated.
Yeah.
Buy it all again, but one thing at a time. I think if anything comes from this, if anything is on this recording right now, then
what if Bill has been with us? We've been talking about it. Bill's come down.
It's Fred
West. I want him coming in.
Oh God, no, not him. No. Fred was the other. It was Bill, and there was Fred as well.
Oh right, I remember.
But
it just makes you feel weird. You get this sort of looking over your shoulder, looking over anxious kind of thing.
Exactly. It's like when you do watch something and it creeps you out.
Yeah.
But then you start to kind of, your eyes glaze a little bit and things seem a little bit misty. That mistiness, I mean, that was my experience that I had was when I was with my ex and we were lying there and we were just talking, and all of a sudden we just stopped talking because we kind of felt oppressed. We felt as though we couldn't talk, couldn't move, and all I remember is just, because I was actually on my back, I remember just seeing this fog just going over her, and then the stopping and this swooping into the chair for a moment before just fading. And as soon as it faded completely, she burst into tears. I said, "Are you alright?" She said, "Yeah, I just felt like something was just on top of me. It was pushing me down, and it was really, really horrible. I don't know what it was. I felt as though I just couldn't move. I couldn't say anything to you. You weren't gonna listen to me. I was screaming inside, and I couldn't say anything. And I just..." And I said, "Well," she says, "Well, what did you say?" I said, "Nothing." She goes, "What did you say?" I said, "I don't know. Just this dark mist was just moving across over you, and then swooping into the chair and then disappearing." She goes, "Why did we just have that? Why? Because we were totally happy. We just watched the Black Cauldron." Disney film.
Yeah.
That couldn't have had any subliminal messages that could have disturbed our minds, could it? But we were just happy, and then we were just chatting, and then the chatting just stopped. Silence. Crying. And it was a very odd thing. And I don't know why. I think there was obviously some sort of a weird energy. Like this now, this kind of feeling of, you know, you don't understand why the lighting in the room is a bit weird.
Yeah.
And you just kind of feel a little bit odd.
Well, it's because the lighting in the room isn't weird. It's the state of mind we're now in.
Yeah.
You're starting to think things were... My friend Alan...
Your shirt's very populated with movement.
Yeah.
That's just because
you... It's the only shirt I could find.
It's just a shirt.
Yeah. But my mate Alan rung me up, and he said, "You're into this ghost stuff, aren't you?" I'm like, at the time, I was doing the evenings, you know, going out in allegedly haunted places and stuff. And... he said, "Something weird happened last night. Can I tell you about it and get your feeling of it?" "Yeah, of course, yeah." So, he got woke up where his stepson had got in bed with him, And he said he can't sleep when he's in bed with him because he just sleeps in weird angles and he's poking him in the ribs. So he got out of bed. He said he went downstairs, got a drink, and went into his stepson's bedroom and got into his bed. He said the moon was sort of shining through, which he'd noticed. And he was just lying on his side. And he just turned over. And there was a boy stood next to the wardrobe. Well, if you know when a footballer wins a goal and he sort of pulls the T-shirt over his head,
yeah,
from the front over his head, he was like stood there with the T-shirt pulled over so you could see his belly and the front of the T-shirt had been pulled up over his head. But his hands were to his side and just stood there. And he thought it was his son, his stepson Joe, so he was like, Joe, you alright, mate? Joe, you okay? Didn't say anything back, just stood there. He was like, Joe. So he got out of bed and went towards him. As he went towards him, he started going backwards, Joe, this boy. But he said that he wasn't moving, so when he looked at his feet, he said his feet were flat to the floor, but we were just gliding backwards, and he just went through a wall.
Messed up, innit?
Yeah.
You don't just make this kind of stuff up. The whole T-shirt over the head thing.
Yeah,
never heard that before.
Well, Alan's an atheist. He doesn't believe in anything like that, you know what I mean? Yeah. But he rung me up. He was freaked out by it.
Yeah.
And he said, I don't believe in ghosts. But I don't know what that was. I saw it. You may have fallen asleep and just thought you'd seen it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It happens all the time to people. But, yeah. It's weird.
I mean, as a young parent, we're constantly thinking that Aspen is between us sleeping.
Yeah.
Because that panic dream of smothering and everything, that's just one of these things that you're constantly... You're looking over and he's in his cot. You know, he's just in there. It's not a problem. But you're constantly thinking that he's where he shouldn't be. You know, and that's and sometimes it's just that emotional state that just kind of brings these feelings and emotions. But what we experienced was just odd. It was just odd, and we both kind of had a shared experience, and I think that was an emotional thing.
Yeah.
But the fact that it just turned on like a tap, and this guy seeing this thing.
I was in Egypt with an ex, went on holiday, and we had a week on the cruise, and the second week was in this hotel.
Yeah.
So I went to bed that night and I was terrified. No reason for it. Absolutely terrified. Couldn't sleep, couldn't do anything. And next day I was all groggy and grumpy bastard, you know. And then the following night, same thing. Just lied there, just terrified of nothing, just scared. So the next night I just said to her, I can't sleep. And she's like saying, it's probably because you're close to the door. Or something. It's a weird room. You've never been here before. I'll sleep in that bed. It was two single beds pushed together.
Yeah.
So I slept fine that night. She was terrified again. She couldn't sleep, but I was fine. So the next few nights, we just slept in a single bed, scrunched up together. When we were leaving, I asked one of the porters, I said, there's something weird in that room, because every time we slept in that bed, we couldn't sleep. We were scared of nothing. A few weeks prior, someone had died in that bed.
It's all about energy. That's weird.
That's energy. Because how terrified he might have been as he was dying.
Fear.
Has gone into the bed, perhaps.
Yeah. Energy. Just absorbing it. Yeah. You know, high impact yield frequencies. A go-go. That's just an emotional feeling. It's fascinating.
Mm.
Fascinating.
Well, as fascinating as it is, Stephen, I think we've gone on for long enough here.
Yeah, we've gone very subdued, and we're kind of like just letting the feeling just take over us.
Yeah.
So as we sit, we like to say, good night, out there, whatever you are.
You know, I want to take this opportunity to let the people know how they can contact our friends of Frame by Frame. They do that podcast thing.
You know, two guys, yeah. They do the podcast, okay? So
They're nice. They're like a forest, which is a beautiful thing.
Exactly. And so if you want to do the communicating thing, you know, the social networking thing.
Yeah, you can you can tweet those guys.
Tweet?
At Frame by Frame 78. If you'd like to go to their website, that will be www.roastedportions.com.
You don't need to do the www. It's implied that it's going to be the World Wide Web.
But people need to know that.
Okay, just go to roastedportions.com, okay? You go down on the right hand side, you've got the social connections. You can talk to the people who do the show. You can even talk to the people who made that movie, you know, CACO3.
Who'd want to talk to those mooks?
I don't know, they made a pretty interesting movie, right?
Yeah.
It was in black and white.
Yeah, black and white.
Yeah,
like,
you know,
that.
We like black and white, because, and there's also some trees in that movie, too.
Oh, trees. It's like being in a forest, which is a beautiful thing.
Other connections, you can really get to know these people on YouTube as well, and if you want to comment on their podcast, I urge you to do that. Okay?
Yeah, I think it is a proper, really nice thing if people want to start contacting these guys.
Subscribe to them and comment. I mean, it's just polite, you know.
Also, you can email them at framebyframe78@gmail.com.
That's it. I think that's everything wrapped up, so.
Hey, I'm gonna go and plant a tree somewhere.
Okay, you go plant some trees.
I'm gonna go and plant a tree.
I'm gonna go tweet.
You tweet, I'll plant a tree.
It's us. We're out of here.